I'd like to welcome you to the ACD seminar, and I'd like to welcome Sasha Albrecht here to NCAR. This is his first trip to NCAR. He's been here this week, and I guess he leaves today, tomorrow. So if you want to talk to him, you need to get him quickly. Sasha's just finishing up his PhD in August at, let's see if I can do this right, Forschungszentrum Jülich, and he got his bachelor's and master's degree at Wuppertal University in Germany, and Thorsten Benter is his advisor. And today he's going to talk to us about some work he's been doing on developing a new instrument with chemical ionization time of flight mass spectrometry.
Thank you for the kind introduction. There are a few people I have to acknowledge. There is Armin Afshin, who made the fluid dynamic simulations of our transfer stage. There's Markus Dick and Heinz Rong, who made the electronic of the instrument. And there's Jochen Bartel, who have helped me with the mechanic. And there's my group leader, Fred Stroh, and my supervisor, Thorsten Benter. So Lee invited me to present you the work of the last 1.5 years, the second part of my PhD thesis, and I hope you will enjoy the talk. But let me give you first a short introduction to our institute at the Forschungszentrum Jülich. It's in English, it's a research center in Jülich. It's a Institute for Energy and Climate Research. We are doing stratospheric chemistry and physics. So our main projects are the modeling of the UTLS, the upper troposphere and lower stratosphere, airborne remote measurements using CLORIA, an infrared instrument. And we are doing in situ measurements. That's where I am working. I'm making mass spectrometer development in cooperation with the University of Wuppertal. So let me give you an outline of my talk. I will talk of the motivation, the challenges of the instrument development, and why we use CETOF, a chemical ionization time of flight mass spectrometer. And well, I will give you a short introduction to transfer elements and the dopant and analyte chemistry. And I will tell you about our development of a high pressure ion funnel. And at last, I will close with the conclusion. So our aims is to measure in the UTLS region. You have transport processes of different sources up in the stratosphere, mainly in the tropics, or by volcanoes, which bring up the interesting species up in the stratosphere, where they make chemistry and aerosols are produced. This chemistry is interesting for us, and we like to measure it with our instrument. Therefore, we like to build a versatile and very sensitive instrument to measure in the ultratrace range. Interesting species for us are mainly sulfuric compounds like sulfuric acid and NOx species, which are the main aerosol parts. In the instrument development, you have a long list of issues you like to face to, and I didn't finalize it. It's still going on, but let's start simple. You have a hot zone where you generate your ions. There you have high energetic reactions. And then you have a gas inlet where you let in your ions and let them react on the reaction zone, typically this is a tube, and you use a transfer stage to get down with the pressure to 10 to the minus 6 hectopascal where the TOF is working, because it needs a collision-free flight path. Why do we use chemical ionization? Simply because we can get selective, and it's a sensitive technique if you have a good instrument. We want to combine it with a time-of-flight instrument because you can measure a broad range of masses in a very short time. You will lose 2 or up to a factor of 5 of sensitivity, but this is not so much. With the quadrupole, you have to scan the masses, and thereby you also lose intensity. Additionally, small instruments are available that have resolutions that are very good, suitable for our instrument, and therefore we have developed our high transmission transfer stage to combine both techniques. Our start point for the chemical ionization was the laminar flow ion source introduced by Eisler et al. It provides good sensitivity, but it has some problems that are published in the literature. There are disturbances by side winds. You have a hot zone that is relative near to your species that you like to measure, and especially at low pressures, diffusion will drive your ions that you like to measure to the hot zone of the ion source. Additionally, we like to reduce the losses in the ion source because you have only a very small pinhole, and so you will lose a lot of gas, and in addition you will lose ions that are pumped out and will not reach your mass spectrometer. And last but not least, you have a radioactive ion source that needs special permissions to be flown, and therefore we like to replace it. Typically, you use a quadrupole transfer stage with 2 quadrupoles and a quadrupole analyzer, which we want to replace by a better transfer stage and a time-of-flight mass spectrometer. What transfer elements do we have for our transfer stage? We have a quadrupole and we have an ion funnel. The quadrupole works up to around about 1 hectopascal. It is made of 4 rods. The blue rods have the positive RF field on it, and the black rods have the opposite phase of the RF signal on it. Therefore, you generate an effective potential that keeps the ions inside the quadrupole. And the ion funnel works with the same principle. It has stacked ring ion guides, stacked ring electrodes that also have an opposite RF phase and generate an effective potential in the funnel that keeps the ions inside. Therefore, you have a wider opening range, and caused by the reduced distance between the electrodes, the electrode gap, you have a higher containment of ions and you can work at higher pressures. This is the concept of our new transfer stage. We have a DBD ion source where we generate our primary reaction ions, our so-called dopant ions that react with the species that we want to measure. They are also sampled by a capillary, and you might ask, aren't there big losses in the capillary? Indeed, you will lose 50% of your ions, but you have a velocity profile over the capillary. Most of your gas flow will flow in the middle of the capillary and will never see a wall if the capillary is short enough. Typically, you use a capillary with an inner diameter of 0.5 millimeters, the so-called transfer capillaries, and you can reach rather high transmission with it. Therefore, you will lose only few ions and sticky molecules in the inlet. After your inlet, you will mix the ions and the species you like to measure, let them react in the 100 hectopascal ion funnel, which guides them directly into the next ion funnel working at 5 hectopascal, and at last in a quadrupole, which guides it to the mass spectrometer. Thereby, you have a separated hot zone. Your plasma is burning in the DBD, and the high energetic particle will not reach your reaction zone. Using a plasma, you have a very brilliant ion source, and you can generate dopants directly in the plasma. And afterwards you guide your ions in the ion funnel while the neutrals are pumped away. This is our plasma. You can see the plasma burning. I hope you can see it. Here you have the high voltage electrode coated with a dielectric, and you have opposite electrode. It's a stainless steel capillary which samples the ions directly into the transfer stage. You have additional ports for the pressure measurement and the gas inlet, and thereby you can control the properties of your plasma ion source. In the ion source you can generate different dopant ions. There is CO3-, NO3-, and I-, which can be used to drive different chemical ionization reaction path. NO3, for example, provides us H2SO4, which can be measured, or by indirect measurements we get other species like OH with a very low detection limit. In the table you see the species that you like to measure, the ion you will measure, and the detection limit found in the literature. CO3- is less selective, and therefore you get a little bit more analyte ions. You get SO2, NO3, H2O2 is interesting, HCN is very interesting for biomass burning, for example. And you also get sulfuric acid. We are very interested where our detection limit is, because we haven't found it yet in the literature. The iodine ion therefore provides bromine species and chlorine species, which are also very interesting in the stratosphere, especially when you want to measure in the region of the ozone hole. These techniques can also be used at atmospheric pressure, and other fields of chemistry are thereby very interesting. But for our study, we mainly look for the stratosphere. So these are two of our transfer elements. Here you have a segmented quadrupole, and below you have a 100 millibar ion funnel. But what are the problems that are connected with these transfer elements? Using the electrostatic fields, you can easily drive reactions, because you put energy in your system, which will at least cause fragmentation. Normally, you can choose between high transmission and a soft transfer. But there are two parameters you can change. There's the flow velocity, which means that if you reduce the mass flow through your transfer element, you will need lower electrostatic fields. This is also true if you increase the pressure. Thereby you can keep the mass transfer, but by increasing the pressure you have lower velocities and will need lower electrostatic fields. You can see that this is true. Here I have some simulations of it. We used a fluid dynamic simulation, which is combined with SimION to use the ion trajectories. And using 2 liters going through the ion funnel, you will lose ions. Using the same parameters, but having only 1 liter at a minute, you will have a good transfer through it. This can be also proven using measurements. Here you have the intensity plotted against an additional flow that is added concentrical to the flow of the plasma ion source. And you can see if you add additional gas, you lose intensity. So where are the limits of a typical ion funnel? Normally you use an electrode gap distance of 0.5 millimeters. And as you can see, somewhere in between 20 and 30 hectopascal, you will have nearly no more transmission. This is caused by the electrostatic field, that the reduced field strength that is reduced by pressure. And you have additionally to look for a factor gamma. This describes the relation in between the collisions and the frequency of the electrostatic fields that drives the ion funnel. If you're getting much slower than the collision frequency, your ions will diffuse through your electrostatic field. Additionally, we looked for the energy in our ion funnel using toluene, because most of the toluene reactions are well known. And here you can see the relative intensity of selected species plotted against the voltage amplitude of the ion funnel. If you increase the voltage, you will destroy the toluene dimer, which isn't very stable. And you see the toluene signal at mass 92. At approximately 90 volt peak, you will start to deprotonate the toluene ion and produce mass 91. Further increasing the voltage, you produce fragments of the toluene ion. And as you can see below, this is the total ion count. You have a maximum transmission at around about 90 volt peak. So we have a maximum of transmission and a relative soft transfer. You can also add water to your system. Then you will see water clusters at mass 19, 37, 55, 70, 30, and 91. At 91, you can see a second maximum at higher voltages, which is again the deprotonated toluene. And at mass 93, you see the protonated toluene ion, which already starts at 30 volt peak. And you can avoid this, but it's easy to get smaller water clusters and get protonation thereby. So, we have built a 100 hectopascal ion funnel, which we so far haven't seen as a SIMS instrument. How did we do it? We simply reduced the electrode distance to 0.25 millimeters, which is a bit challenging, but it works. To work at that high pressure, we also need a higher driving frequency. We are working at 10 megahertz, and so far we have tested it at up to 240 volt peak. This works pretty good. We have a transmission of 30%, and we think that we easily can reach 50% getting up with the voltage. because the breakthrough voltage is at approximately 360 volt peak. And you can see here some pictures of the ion funnel. The electrodes are very dense, but we made it. We made some simulations of the ion funnel to see whether our concept could work before we made measurement and build it. And at 200 volt peak, you can see you won't have any good transmission. But getting up to 300 volt peak, you will already have something around about 50% transmission. And in the measurements, we have seen that our transmission starts to increase above 200 volt peak. And you also can get a very high transmission, but this is above the breakthrough voltage. But I think 50% are not that bad. So these are our transmission we have reached. 30% for the 100 hectopascal ion funnel, 50% for the 5 hectopascal ion funnel, and also 50% for the quadrupole, which includes the luces at the next nozzle. And we think that we can reach 50% for the 100 hectopascal ion funnel, increasing the voltage. We think that we also can improve the 5 hectopascal ion funnel a bit, decreasing the mass flow through it. And for the quadrupole, we are not really sure we can further improve it, but there might be some options. Let me say a word to the transfer through the 100 millibar ion funnel. It's relatively soft because the reduced field strength is a factor of 10 lower compared to the 5 hectopascal ion funnel. And therefore, we think that we will have a really soft transfer. If you like to compare it to the 5 hectopascal ion funnel, it's somewhere in the range of the 5 hectopascal ion funnel working at 30 volt peak. So it's just in the region where you start to protonate the toluene ion. Yeah, we are already at the conclusions. We have built a high transmission transfer stage, and we have identified the final improvements. We have introduced a brilliant plasma ion source, which also can generate our dopant ions. And it's relatively small, so you can also use multiple ion sources in one instrument and combining maybe different chemistries. We have built an ion funnel working at 100 hectopascal, and we have introduced the concept to make your reaction zone in the 100 hectopascal ion funnel, and therefore we will lose only few ions. And we have identified a range of dopant ions, and therefore we are ready for first ground-based measurements to characterize our instrument. Thank you for listening. Yes.
We are recording this, so I have to pass the microphone around for questions.
So a couple of practical questions. So are you intending to actually change the reaction ions, the reagent ions, during the flights, or just stick with one reagent ion for the whole?
We have to see how good this works, but it might be possible to do this.
Okay. And what is the goal in terms of, you say the first ground-based measurements are taking place soon. Is it? Do you have a specific time in mind for actually doing stratospheric measurements, or is
we might have. My group leader likes to have the instrument on the plane at 2016, but this is challenging.
Oh, okay.
So what's the insulator that you use between the elements? Is that the main thing that keeps that determines your breakdown voltage?
Between
electrodes.
Between the funnel electrodes?
Yeah.
You just have air.
Just have air.
Okay. We have spacers at the edges, but in between the electrodes you only have air because you want to pump in between.
I'm curious about your plasma source. Do you see background issues on your detector because of the plasma? Like, you know, we quite often use things like cold cathode discharge.
No, we haven't seen some
really
problems like this yet.
So that's is it because it's a less intense light or because of just the tortuous path it has to go through to get through the TOF?
I don't know.
You don't know? Okay.
We haven't seen problems with it, and okay. It works pretty well. I think it also depends on the electronics you use. And
okay.
I mean, the ground is the same like the instrument, mm-hmm. But it works pretty well up to now.
Okay. Thank you.